Hello everyone, I am Tanvi Kaur and I welcome you to this series called RBI 247. In this very series, we'll be picking up some important financial topics and we'll try to discuss the concepts with the help of different questions. So before getting started, for all those who are watching this video for the very first time, you can subscribe to our channel and press this bell icon for all latest updates and notifications. You can also join our Telegram group where you will be getting some free quizzes, the updates for all videos, and you can also post your queries over here. Now, before beginning up with the session today, I would like to share a piece of information with you all. As you all know that exams are quite near, so we have come up with the crash course which will help you ace your RBI Grade B preparation. So in this very course, we will be providing you with all the necessary material which can help speed up your process of preparing for your Grade B exams. So this course has been launched at 40% discount offer. You can use this coupon code and avail this discount. Now, if you want to fetch further details, you can visit our website and see the course details. So let's get started. This is the very first question, which says, what does it refer to over here? So again, as you can see, here are two statements mentioned and we have to identify the concept like we used to do in our previous sessions. So let's read these statements one by one. The first one says, it is the bankruptcy law of India which seeks to consolidate the existing framework by creating a single law for your insolvency and bankruptcy. Let's read the second statement as well and then we'll discuss this concept. Second statement says, it was enacted to provide a time-bound process to resolve insolvency among the companies and individuals. So what is this concept which is being talked about in the question? The concept talks about a bankruptcy law. How is this law helping? It is helping in resolution of all the insolvency and bankruptcy cases. As I discussed in my last session where I covered the NPAs portion, I told you that there are different steps which have been undertaken to resolve the problem of NPAs. Okay, some of them included your SERFICI Act, your debt recovery tribunals, corporate debt restructuring, asset reconstruction companies, and I also mentioned another very important thing which was the IBC code, that is the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code of 2016. So that code is actually being referred to over here. What happened was the laws which existed before IBC, they were a lot fragmented and it took a lot of time to resolve the cases of insolvency and bankruptcy. So there was no one law which will cover all the cases for your insolvency, for your bankruptcy. So came up the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. It was a single window, an umbrella legislation which will cover all the insolvency and the bankruptcy cases. And that also in a time-bound manner. Earlier, lot of time got wasted in the resolution process. So they came up with the concept of resolving these insolvency and bankruptcy cases within a time span of 180 days with 90 days additionally allowed in certain cases. So a total of 270 days window was allowed to resolve the cases. Further, this period was enhanced to 330 days. This 270 days period didn't include the litigation time. As you all know, a lot of time gets wasted in the court procedures, or there are a lot of procedural delays and the litigation time. So a new deadline was prescribed for 330 days and it was going to include the litigation time. So it was an amendment which was made later on. So this way, by specifying the time limit, it sets a time-bound process for resolving all your insolvency and bankruptcy cases. So if you look at this question, the concept talked about here is IBC code of 2016. Why it's not a debt recovery tribunal or a SERFICI Act? See, there are also some steps which are undertaken for the NPA resolution and for this handling these problems of insolvency or bankruptcy, but they were not that time bound, nor they were a single law. So these two things mentioned over here help us, and this thing as well, it's the bankruptcy law. These three things make us understand that the answer to this question should be the IBC code. Now let's move on to question number 2. It says, which of the following correctly states the objectives of insolvency and the bankruptcy code. So we have to identify the objectives which are correct over here. Let's first discuss some of the objectives and then we read the question once again. So why do we need this code? As I've already told you, it's a law to handle all your insolvency and bankruptcy cases. So it's going to help in resolution. It's going to help in deciding whether we need to liquidate the assets, we need to close the business, or we can make it function in an improved manner and recover the amount. Secondly, it helps in the time-bound recovery, which was not covered under the previous legislations or previous steps which were undertaken for NPA resolution. Moreover, it's also going to ensure the confidence of the banks, the foreign investors and the companies. Now, if your NPAs or stressed assets are all getting properly resolved, your insolvency and bankruptcy things are getting resolved in a time-bound manner, maybe they are this code is helping in the early recovery and also making sure that business continue to run, then in that case, it's going to increase the credibility of the system. It's going to make sure that people are taking credit and they are also returning it back. Even the situations of NPA can be resolved properly. So it will boost up your economy. More people will get interested in investing in your nation. The banks will also feel satisfied. So they will also lend more credit. More credit, more business, more growth of the economy. So this was the objective which this code catered to. Moreover, it provided a speedy process for identifying all your financial distress and helping in the resolution part for the entities. Thirdly, it helped in what? It helped in the insolvency resolution of the corporate persons also, of the partnership firms also, and the individuals as well, and that also in a time-bound manner. Now, all these things are going to promote what? They will ensure more credit, easy credit, because they know that the recovery process is good. Then that will promote more credit, will promote more entrepreneurship. It will, as it is ensuring more availability of credit, which will also increase the chances of doing business, and thus facilitate higher investments in your nation, ensuring economic growth and development. The same thing which I discussed in the first point as well. Moreover, the objective of this code was to reduce the time of recovery. As I already told you earlier, it took a long time to recover the amount. So that time has been reduced with the help of this code. Then it also focused on increasing the realizable value. Now, instead of shutting down the business and selling off the assets to get the amount recovered, this code also focused on how to make sure that the business continues to run and the amount gets recovered. Moreover, the focus is on recovering as much assets as possible. So, increase in the realizable value, whatever could be realized, one should realize that was again the objective of this code. Now let's move back to the question and have a look at the options. We have to identify the correct objectives. Okay, so the first one says code provides clear and speedy process for early identification and resolution of financial distress. This statement is absolutely correct. The second one says the objective was to ensure the insolvency resolution of only corporate persons. When this word only comes up, it is wrong, because it ensures the insolvency resolution process for your partnership firms also, for other individuals also. So we can't just restrict it to the corporate persons term. Third statement says to increase the time of recovery from 1 to 2 years. First of all, the objective was not to increase but to decrease the time of recovery. In India, it took more than 4 years to recover that amount. So they have reduced that time period to 180 plus 90, that is 270 days, and then to 330 days, because that 270 days didn't include your litigation time. So in 330 days, now they are focusing on resolving the thing. So this statement is absolutely wrong. The last one says to increase the average realizable value. This is correct, as I've already told you. So which one is correct? First and fourth. So the answer is option D. Now let's move on to question number 3. It says, which of the following statements is or are incorrect about your bankruptcy code? So we have to identify the incorrect statements. Let's just read the first statement so that we can identify what we have to discuss before attempting this question. So the first statement is about the institutional infrastructure under IBC resting on two pillars. So before reading other statements, let's just discuss the pillars of IBC, then we'll move back to this question. So there are four different pillars of IBC. These can also be called as important features of IBC. What we have to focus upon, on what four pillars is this code build? So the first pillar is the insolvency professionals. Now there is a big process which needs to be carried out for resolving order insolvency and bankruptcy cases. A normal person may not be able to carry out all those tedious procedures himself. So a professional person is appointed under this code. These professionals are the ones who will help you in the resolution process. They may take up your business and help it to recover. They may sell off your assets. So whatever things are undertaken, they are undertaken under the guidance of these professional people who are appointed. Second pillar is information utility. So they provide certain utility services like keeping a record of all your financial information, disseminating the information to necessary people at the proper time. Then they make the database of whom, of the lenders, that how much has been lended by which lender to whom. So that later on when the insolvency problems come up, you don't have to compile the information then, and the ready information is already available. So maintaining the databases, keeping the record of all financial information, of the lenders, of how much has been lent, all this is kept done by the information utilities. Then we have another pillar, that is of the adjudicating authorities. In the last session, I discussed about the debt recovery tribunals. So other than those debt recovery tribunals, we also have the National Company Law Tribunal. So both of these are the adjudicating authorities. They will be handling your cases of your insolvency and bankruptcy. As far as the individuals are concerned, they will be covered by the debt recovery tribunals. And as far as the corporate resolution process is concerned, that will be covered by NCLT. So we don't need to approach the courts, but these tribunals which are set up for your insolvency resolution process. And the last pillar is that of the insolvency regulator, IBBI, that is Insolvency and Bankruptcy Board of India. This is the body which regulates the insolvency and bankruptcy code. So it is going to regulate or provide an oversight for your professionals, for your utility, information utility. So they are going to govern the whole process. In fact, you can fetch the necessary details about this code, about the amendments from your IBBI website only. So these were four pillars which helps in making this insolvency and resolution process more stronger. Now let's move back to our question. So the question, we have to identify the incorrect statement. So the first one was that the institutional frame infrastructure under IBC rests on only two pillars, insolvency professional and adjudicating authorities. This is wrong. We just discussed the four pillars. Second statement says NCLT and DRT, that is the National Company Law Tribunal and Debt Recovery Tribunal, are the adjudicating authorities and they ensure smooth functioning of your bankruptcy process. This statement is absolutely correct. And the last one says the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Board of India is the body that has regulatory oversight over your insolvency professionals, insolvency professional agencies, the information utilities. This is the thing which I discussed while discussing about the IBBI. So only the first statement is incorrect. Answer is option A. Let's move ahead further. This is the fourth question. Let's have a look at it. Which of the following statements correctly states the section 10A of Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code Amendment 2020? Now, before beginning up with this question, reading these statements, let me discuss about this amendment. It's not that IBC code came in 2016 and it stayed the same. No, various improvements have been made to the code. Like I've already told you earlier, 270 days was the resolution period. Then it was increased to 330 days, including litigation. So many such changes have been suggested under different amendments which have come up. There was an amendment in 2018, 2019, and this question talks about the 2020 amendment. If you want to study about these amendments in detail, you can visit the website of IBBI, where you will be having the insolvency and bankruptcy code, where you will be having all the necessary PDFs related to the updations or the amendments which have taken place in this very code. So this question was about a 2020 amendment of section 10A. So what is this amendment? We all know that 2020 was basically a period of pandemic. Because of COVID-19, various things have changed and an amendment was made in this regard to our IBC code as well. So what was this amendment? A new section was inserted, section 10A. Now during this time period of COVID, lots of people were there who were basically not able to return the money. They were not having money. So insolvency and bankruptcy code is not focusing on resolving the amount of that time period, because that was basically an exceptional situation. So what did this section say? This section stated that no one can file an application. No application can be filed for what? For the corporate insolvency resolution plan. No corporate can file an application to resolve their insolvency case if the default occurred between 25th March to 24th September. So from 25th March up till a period of 6 months. During the 6 months time, if any case of insolvency comes up, then for that time period, no one can file an application for the resolution process. Secondly, this provision stated that it clearly mentioned that no application can ever be filed for this 6 months time period. People might think that, okay, aaj hame application file nahi kar sakte, we'll file it sometime later. Ki kuch time baad jaake is time period ke liye, we'll recover the amount. But they have clearly stated that you cannot ever make an application for recovery of this amount. So this is the exceptional case which has been added in this 2020 amendment. Now let's move back to our question and read these statements and identify the statements which correctly states this section. So the first one says that the application for initiation of corporate insolvency resolution process shall be filed for default occurred on or after 25th March with evidentiality. The application cannot be filed. So this statement is wrong. Second one states no application for initiation of CIRP can be filed. This statement is correct. The third one says the application for initiation of CIRP, that is the Corporate Insolvency Resolution Plan, can be filed after 31st December. Absolutely not. Never ever can you file for the resolution process for this 6 month time period. And the last one says no application shall ever be filed for this resolution process. This statement is again correct. So which statement is correct? Second and fourth, right? So second and fourth are correct and we had to identify the correct statements. Answer is option D. I hope the amendment is quite clear to you now. So this was all for today's session. As far as the IBC code is concerned, you should be very clear about what this code says. What do you mean by the IBC code? What are its functions? On what pillars is it built? How it functions? Then what are the major amendments which have been made to this very code? So this was all for today's session. With this, I would like to end up this session. Thank you so much.